members IMEI and CMMI, delegates, members of various committees, guests of the occasion, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of APJ Shipping Limited, a shipping company with a legacy of more than 7 decades of sustained growth, the largest shipping company in this marvelous city, I am pleased to join you and welcome you in this first ever shipping conference in Calcutta. I commend the conference's focus, maritime sustainability, global opportunities. Sustainability is most often and rightly so discussed at conferences in connection to and shipping industry's contribution to environmental sustainability. When we speak of sustainability, it comprises of environmental, social, and economic sustainability. Today, environmental sustainability in shipping goes hand in hand with economic sustainability. COVID-19 has ravaged the world economy in general. The pandemic has demonstrated that shipping is an essential service. While the demand for shipping is a derived demand, this fact cannot remain inspicuous anymore. Our industry and industry people have proven themselves to be the very backbone and lifeblood of the world economy. We have kept the world economy moving, helping in sustaining trade and moved goods. Hundreds of thousands of seafarers have tirelessly been performing their duties around the clock in spite of the fatigue brought about by long contracts, nil shore leave, and ever-present pressures of the maritime industry. While issues pertaining to crew change have more or less been resolved in Indian ports, thanks to the keen interest and commitment in the welfare of seafarers from the Shipping Ministry and the Director General of Shipping, crew changes in foreign ports still remains a challenge. There are only a few handful of ports and nations that have shown their commitment to the welfare of seafarers in practice. The positive outcome of COVID-19 related crew change is that it has forced cooperation world over, and such a collaboration heralds a fresh approach to challenges faced by shipping. The year 2020 has been a unique one in many ways. We started the year with the IMO's 2020 sulfur cap, which the industry quickly learned to live with. Next came the COVID-19 pandemic that was totally unexpected. It, however, ushered in a focus on digitalization. The maritime community is now more connected digitally, and vessel owners, managers, and operators are becoming more dependent, in fact, more confident of digital solutions for optimization of operations, leading to more collaboration. Soon, the requirements of cybersecurity is going to be an integral part of the safety management system, thus providing necessary safety. Speaking of digitalization, the application of blockchain technology could provide a greater compliance, integrity of transactions, cargo security, and savings. The forecast that there is going to be a surge in all major economies in 2021 bodes well for the maritime industry. COVID-19 vaccines reaching the final trial phase with at least 3 major companies has been a major fillip to the market sentiment. Goldman Sachs, in his latest report, calls the global economic recovery to be a V for vaccine-shaped recovery. The line between operational efficiency, environmental efficiency, and energy efficiency are blurring day by day. Despite all the gloom and doom in the year so far, there are a number of bright spots for the future, providing immense opportunities in practically every aspect of shipping. Thus, innovation into each of these cannot be far behind. While we want to go back to zero emissions in a few decades, shipping has thrived for many millennia with zero emissions till steam power entered the scene, with focus increasing on using renewables for propulsion, such as rotor sails that use Magnus effect and large sails promising up to 90% reduction in emission, solar power, and so on. We seem to have come a full circle. Technologically speaking, concepts of smart ship, digital twin, voyage optimization, etc., areas seriously looked into today by ship operators. There are more than 24 energy efficient technologies available today, including propeller, boss cap fin, pre-swirl duct, solar power, air lubrication, sails, wind kite, and so on. While some of them are part of new designs, many of them can be retrofits. International shipping regulations have always impacted the supply-demand balance in one way or the other. With the most important topic in shipping today namely decarbonization and IMO's target to achieve 40% reduction in average carbon intensity by 2030 and 70% before mid-century compared to 2008 levels, we can expect a slew of measures going forward, such as the recent outcomes of MEPC 75 that requires energy efficiency existing ship index and the rating scheme on operational carbon intensity indicator for even existing ships. These regulations could very well decide the nature of investments in existing vessels, demolition and replenishment of vessels. Owners who want to invest in new technologies and maintain vessels at higher rating will benefit commercially. Investment in new successful designs are certain to bear fruit. Similarly, investing in green recycling facilities can literally build fuel for future. The target set by IMO for 2050 is going to require R&D into alternative fuels such as LNG, LPG, methanol, biofuel and hydrogen, and other options including battery systems, fuel cells and wind-assisted propulsion. The recent coverage on ammonia, a non-carbon fuel, as a viable solution has caught the attention of major engine makers. It would be interesting to see the kind of alternative fuels that would be available by 2050. Shipping finance is now very much focused on environmental sustainability. 18 major banks that control about $150 billion of shipping finance are signatories to Poseidon Principles, a global framework for responsible ship finance, with an aim to promote international shipping's decarbonization. On the other hand, biggest names in chartering have vowed to make details of their shipping carbon footprint public as part of the Sea Cargo Charter Association. Shipping companies should also get access to cheaper sustainability-linked loans, a first of which has recently been granted to PSA Marine Singapore from DBS Bank. With IMO deliberating on a $5 billion funding to R&D of low carbon and zero carbon fuels, energy sources, propulsion systems and other GHG reduction technologies, there would be rapid changes in ship designs as we progress in time. In India, the government's initiative of Atmanirbhar Bharat has already resulted in more push to domestic manufacturing. In shipping, the measures already executed, such as ROFR to vessels built in India and operated by Indian companies in shipping tenders, and measures on the anvil such as the Coastal Shipping Bill and the National Logistics Policy would provide support to coastal shipping and technological adoption in the logistics sector. Both in the Indian and global scenario, maritime sustainability is full of opportunities. People, planet, prosperity, peace and partnership are crucial for sustainable development. Culture is an enabler of environmental and social sustainability, and diversity and inclusion are an integral part. COVID-19 has already shown how the industry can adapt, be youthful and agile, and go digital. For this, we deserve all the recognition we can get. Pursuing diversity in crew and gender equality will make us the magnet for the best talent in the world. APJ has been focusing on hiring more women at TME positions on board, and technical positions have also been held by women at our office. APJ Shipping is also part of a global alliance to shut down illegal wildlife trade. Friends, as members of the shipping industry, we are all already brave, professional and disciplined. Let us also become collaborative and inclusive. Let the next decade be the one of change that propels growth. I wish the conference a grand success and thank the organizers for inviting me to be a part of this conference in the city of Calcutta. Thank you.